So this afternoon, we are privileged to have with us again Dr. Dan Steinbach. He will discuss a recent G20 summit held in Hamburg, Germany, looking at changing dynamics in the leadership of the United States, China, and the European Union in relation to the most relevant issues such as climate change and free trade. So Dr. Dan Steinbach is CEO and founder of The Difference Group. Aside from his advisory activities, he serves as Research Director of International Business at the India, China, and America Institute, and a visiting fellow at the Shanghai Institutes for International Studies in China in the EU Center in Singapore. Dr. Steinbach is recognized worldwide as an expert of the multipolar world. His body of work focuses on international business, international relations, investment and risk among the major advanced economies, as well as large emerging economies, multipolar trends in stocks, bonds, currencies, and commodities. He writes commentaries that are regularly released in the Rubini Global, Economonitor, CNBC, EU Observer, China Daily, among others. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm welcome to Dr. Dan Steinbach.
Thank you. It's a great pleasure to be here back. And I and my wife now spend here 2 or 3 months per year. I consider myself to be a Filipino in progress.
Yes.
I spend that amount also elsewhere, but I've already been in Europe and US and China. So this is a new experience. It has been a very intriguing experience and one that we are only glad to continue more. The subject matter, I will focus on only on certain aspects of it. We don't have so much time, after all, and I simply want to focus on the most important issues here. About my background, the only thing that I want to emphasize here is that the approach that I use, it differs from, especially with the scenario building, it differs from the one that we normally use, especially if you use it in the US, which is based on the idea that at least implicitly, that what has worked in the advanced economies will work in emerging economies. I come from the Gunnar Milberg school of old development economics that thinks that it's a very naive and sometimes simplistic and occasionally dangerous way to look at things. The other thing that's different from many others is that we look at both emerging and advanced economies. We look back in the beginning of industrialization and as far to the future that we only can. The commentaries are published all over the place. If you want to get a basic idea, you can just look at thedifferencegroup.net. So these are the subjects or the topics that I will briefly discuss, only some of them. First, a general picture about what happened in G20 in Hamburg. Secondly, what do we know about the key participants or countries, their economic outlook? Thirdly, what were the key issues? And I will focus on two, world trade and climate, more on trade, but then a number of strategic issues that are bound to come up over time as well. And finally, we look what next. So this is a slide that I've always carried with myself for maybe the past 10, well, now more than 10 years. On the left-hand side, you have the contraction during the global crisis, financial crisis, 2008 and 9. And the point being that only in Asian countries, Middle East and Africa, you had the same pattern, the contraction, but it was always positive, it was never negative. And the second point, that only in Asia, to the degree it filtered down, not the way it should have, in the sense that growth would have translated to individual well-being, but certainly better than in Africa and the Middle East. The second picture on the right describes not just about the business cycles or the fluctuations, but the structural transition that we've seen. This massive transition, ongoing transition, from emerging economies as source of global growth or advanced economies towards emerging economies. It's known as the so-called BRICS theory. I think that's sort of a simplistic way to look at things, but we all use the term and we have a general idea what it means, so I tend to use it at times as well. Now that's actually very relevant when you look at G20. If you take a longer perspective, longer here meaning half a century, much longer than that. It could have it, though. We used to talk about G7. The Japanese analyst Kenny Kiyomai used to call or talk about triad power until late 1980s. The idea that the world is really driven by Western Europe, Japan, and the United States. And they drive it economically, politically, strategically. And this took life relatively well until 1990s. Already before the crisis began around 2007, China and India, together with Russia and Brazil, were greater players in global growth prospects than advanced economies as such. There was always uneasiness with the so-called BRIC countries, the G7. I think former President Lula expressed it best. He said that he had the impression that whenever there was a G7 meeting, and sometimes they were invited as observers, the real meetings happened behind closed doors, but when there was a moment for coffee, that's usually when the BRIC countries were invited in. So they had a feeling that they were sort of wallflowers. Decisions were made elsewhere. The good news was that finally we are in the same location. The bad news is we cannot affect the decision making. That moment came around 2008 in the fall. It was a very precarious moment and far more precarious than we knew at the time. If things had got any worse, most likely we would have had the second global depression. It didn't go that far, but it was close. And one of the major reasons I believe that did not happen was that there was a clear understanding on the part of the industrialized nations that the problems are now so serious, and they affect particularly the West, that that alone, that regions alone cannot find a way out from this. You need the help of the large emerging economies, the ones we call BRICS, but further, still others. There had been a G8, which basically was a G7 plus Russia. That was an uneasy alliance because the Western countries felt that the interests and the values of Russia were so different. And ultimately, with the crisis in Crimea, and so on and so forth, there was a clear suspension of the role of Russia from G8. So BRICS comes in through the back door in G28. And at the time, Strauss-Kahn, who used to be the former head of IMF, really had a lot to do with it. If it had been not for his persistence and bullying, I'm not quite sure it would have happened. All of these characters have personal characteristics that we may not be so crazy about, whether they are presidents of the greatest nation on earth or others. But what they do in these organizations matters. And Strauss-Kahn was able to force these two sets of countries together. It has not happened ever since. And they all pay as a result of that, I think. So now these BRIC countries and others come in. I, out of curiosity, looked at the following. Now, the next summit will be in Argentina, then in Japan, then in Saudi Arabia. But consider this. If you look at the G20 countries in terms of size, those who are part of G20, here you have a list on the left-hand side. EU, we should sort of suspend because it's there as a regional representative. But if you look at the countries, and then you, out of curiosity, you would look at 2050 on the basis of what we know today. I asked myself, which countries would be in, which countries would be out? I mean, how did G20 countries really, how were they created? Was there a long democratic process? Were there a lot of decision makers from different countries? Oh, no. It was the then Treasury Secretary Geithner and his German counterpart who sat down, thought now who would be appropriate. And so it became that way. Philippines out, Nigeria out, Brazil in, and so on and so forth. They decided this beyond the heads of the emerging markets. Most of the designations make sense, but not all of them. So if you look at the present from the point of view of 2050, we'd find that Australia might be out. Saudi Arabia might be out, if you look only at size. But remember, economic size and strategic importance are two different things. Argentina might be out. South Africa might be out. Now, Nigeria might be in. This will be a very big country by 2050. But will it be a strong country? That's a very different question. Vietnam might be, Pakistan might be, Philippines might be, Iran might be. Based on the assumption of Goldman Sachs 10 years ago, out of curiosity, and those numbers I can't show you because I'm still working on it, I looked at what has happened since the first BRICS projections and now. And if you take a very detailed look, you'll find that already there are countries that are falling behind, countries that are moving faster. Nobody's moving up ahead very fast. We are now in a very different environment. So G20 in Hamburg happened, and the idea was that when it happens, there will be no violence, there will be demonstrations, but it all will be peaceful. wrong, that was not the case. We are now in a situation that's more comparable, I think, to what happened in Seattle towards the end of the 90s. That surprised many people in the US major economies. Because globalization had come to a point where people representing those countries no longer had patience with it. They felt that they were victims of globalization. It was not controlled. Ecological groups hated it because of the environmental reasons. Emerging markets had a lot of problems because it seemed to benefit mostly the advanced economies, except for the largest emerging economies, and so on and so forth. But these discontent, I think, has come back. And I think it would be naive to believe that it will not manifest in the next summit as well. If you take the sort of the media take, there was a lot of talk about photos. Now, there was a lot of talk about the photos of Mr. Trump and Chancellor Angela Merkel. And it was true, when you look at that picture, I think I have personally never seen the two being so uncomfortable. But they still had to smile for the picture. It was a very difficult situation because to Trump, Mrs. Merkel represented everything that he's against, and vice versa. And at the same time, they had to get along somehow. What was new and symbolic and very important, I think, was the following kiss between Mr. Emmanuel Macron and Chancellor Merkel, in that there was a moment of time, maybe 5, 8 years ago, when you had a similar kind of understanding between Germany and France. But then it was between Merkel and Sarkozy, both of whom represented the same parties. Macron might be a little bit more centrist according to his own testimony, but when you look at his financiers, they're the same conservative ones as before. So there is a lot that unites them. And certainly when you look at their policy bases, there's quite a lot in common. Germany and France today can say about most things that we have the same values, we have the same interests, which is something they cannot say with the United States, as long as Mr. Trump will be leading the nation, which may or may not change in a matter of a year or two. And then there was this odd situation, somewhat new to those who tend to think of West as a kind of a fixed concept, but not so new to those who feel that everything is malleable, everything is in change, it's just change that matters. So West might not be the key term here. The ability to change with times without compromising your basic interests might be the most important principle. And that brought together Mr. Xi Jinping and Chancellor Merkel. Notice there's no kiss. It's a preliminary relationship. It's a bit like the old movie Casablanca, the wonderful phrase that, you know, this might be the beginning of a wonderful relationship. But in the movie, it didn't exactly happen. The reality might be different. I think in the long term, actually, the foundation is there. And there's quite a lot that's common to Germany and China. I think that when you look beyond the political system of China, if you can, for a moment, suspend everything that has to do with it, and you think of the people that you met, you think the way they think, there are certain differences and similarities, but much more similarities with present-day Germany, including the idea of top-down change and the role of the government implementing change. We have that common picture of the world leaders, and there was a lot of talk why Mr. Trump was all the way to the side. Well, that's it was not an internal protest by the G20. But here we come to the crux of the problem. If you look at the world GDP, the United States still accounts for it, maybe 20-25%. EU about the same, China soon about the same. So where are their values and interests now? If you look at the immediate or the manifest results of the meeting, I think that there are four. In terms of trade, G20 declared its opposition to protectionism, but there was no clear commitment to free trade. These kind of meetings are a little bit like, in the Middle Ages in Europe, the meetings of Jesuits. There was always a certain liturgy that you had to commit to, you had to subscribe to. And if it wasn't repeated word by word, people ascribed a lot of meanings to it, attributed a lot of meanings to it. And this time they did it for a reason, because due to the pressure by the US, a couple of phrases were added. The use of, or the role of, legitimate trade defense instruments. Notice it was not defined, which is very important. If you define it, then you're stuck with the definition, and nobody wants that. But if you define it very ambiguously, you can use that meaning for your own benefit in the long run. And there was a term which has ominous sound, and that is the trade defense instruments. Does it mean something that happened with the Plaza Agreement in mid-1980s? Does it mean protectionism of sorts, disguised as free trading? we don't have an idea yet. What is clear is that most of the G20 is not behind it. US is the only one who wanted to have those terms, but let's be real, it's not only the US who... The US wanted to have those terms there, but when you look at the behavior of the G20 countries, maybe 4 or 5 do have investment protectionism that is de facto reflects those words. Now, the second was an agreement to disagree. It was an agreement by G19 with, and a disagreement with the one, and that's the US. And I will talk soon about a bit about why this is not exactly a big surprise. And there are a lot of things in US that have happened over time, but most of us, I think, and I claim to know something about this since I came from originally from Europe, spent more time in Asia, have been in US since 1986. But there is this perception of the United States as the liberator of Europe in 1945. And it's the right picture for many reasons. But few moons have gone by ever since, and things are changing, and the interests of the countries change as well over time. So the US approach to climate is very, very different from that of Europe right now. And from my point of view, Mr. Trump simply is saying directly and explicitly what the background force is behind. Even President Obama said silently and in the dark. Those voices are now out in the open. They have been legitimized. It's very dangerous, but perhaps better that now we know more about them. The third, and clear agreement, the intention to work more closely together to fight terrorism. But of course, unfortunately, the inability to really create joint activities in that regard. I've always thought, working with emerging and advanced economies, that there's only one way to resolve terrorism in the long run, and that is to have the United States, European leaders, Japan, Russia, China, India, Brazil in the same table, talking seriously and distributing information. As long as you have the Western countries only, or 4 or 5 countries, so-called Five Eyes, who distribute and participate in information gathering that's top secret, it simply won't work. The information will not go where it should go. But when it starts moving around, this information, then you make yourself vulnerable as well, and by the same token. And that's naturally the concern of the United States. If we have to give this information out, what's in it for us, really? How do we ensure that it's used in ways that's appropriate or, quote-unquote, according to our interests? That's the problem. Now, the fourth point, I think, was more symbolic. Most countries in the G20 would agree on that. A certain money allocation was made available for microloans to assist women in developing nations. It's an important issue, but my sense is that, for instance, Mrs. Merkel's support for this agenda item prior to the summit was based a lot on the ideas that it would help to negotiate with the Americans about it, the things that were far more important to Germany and other advanced and emerging economies. Quickly, a very quick charade or cavalcade of nations where they are. In terms of US, a great surprise in that when Mr. Trump came in, there was this thinking that the economy will start suffering immediately, the stock market will go down. We saw exactly the reverse. But people thought that things would be a lot better by now, and they are not. And we thought there would be continuity, and right now it's harder to see. There's also an underlying conflict that's harder to understand, and that's between the executive arm of the United States, meaning the Trump administration, and the Federal Reserve. The Fed wants to tighten, and they were very assertive in December. The only thing that's stopping them, really, is the Trump administration and the uncertainty associated with that. Trump wants to have cheap loans to implement his infrastructure program. The higher the interest rates, the harder it is for him, the more he will pay for that. And he's a businessman. He wants to have the art of the deal, as he says. So this is the underlying conflict. However, whichever way we look at the US, I think the economy is fairly resilient. It's on a better basis than Europe. In Europe, people would like to change things, but they don't have the institutions for it. In America, you have the institutions, but not the willingness. It's a very ironic situation in that regard. Most troublesome aspect of this is a $20 trillion plus sovereign debt, which now exceeds maybe 106% of the GDP. And no credible, no bipartisan medium-term debt reduction plan. And as a result, we've seen also less revenues than expected. So the debate on the debt ceiling that was supposed to come in the fall may actually happen already earlier, meaning that it might happen towards the end of the summer or very early in the Paul, and that's another polarizing issue in commerce, and that's the last thing that the communists would now need. Nonetheless, the growth itself, 2% plus in the immediate future, and even 2% or a bit less in the future, pretty good in the circumstances. Another thing, there was a lot of talk when Mr. Trump won the election. I was one of those who felt, and is on public record, that saying prior to the election that there's a potential for the Trump triumph. And the reason, I think, is that you really have to look at the unemployment figures very seriously. You really have to look at the white middle class, how they have shrank, and the, especially the lower middle class, and the resentment. And you have to look at other indicators. For instance, the suicide rates are accelerating among young middle class white men in a way that we've never seen in the post-war era. So there are some really valid and trends that would make you very concerned. Now, if you look at here this picture, if Trump was a surprise, it is not reflected by the long-term trends of the US economy and politics. Here we have the first one, which is about the direction of the country. The red one is those who disagree about the direction, the blue, those who agree. Since 2003, meaning after Iraq, there has been a clear polarization in America. Most Americans feel the country is totally opting for the wrong way. And that hasn't changed. It got worse in the Obama era. Despite all the promises, it got worse. And it's about the same now. No surprise, really. Nothing has changed if you look at this figure on. Second, Trump job approval. Much has been made that his ratings have collapsed. I think that he may have lost 30% of his core constituencies. That's a position where he can be some of the time, but not all of the time. He has to reverse it. And some of the things he does right now may be less aimed at China or Europe or Philippines or whoever, but his own constituencies. He wants to tell them, I'm in charge. But when you look at his job approval, from the beginning of the days to the present, in the very beginning, America was divided. Now most people feel that, well, this is not what we wanted. But it's not the collapse. It's something that could still change. And honestly, if I had the Obama approval rate, not so different. Compare this with the Congress job approval from 1994 to the present, and what you will find is that there's this huge blue spike. That was September 11, 2001. It had nothing to do with Congress's work. It had to do with the idea that we're united when there's a crisis. Then that was gone ever since. It is so bad that the support for the Congress is now less than 20%. So when the US president has an approval rate of maybe 40 right now, and the Congress has maybe 20%, and Putin has 80, apparently, and so has Xi Jinping, by American bolsters, not Chinese or Russian, that makes you think. That makes you think about the uncertainties and the fragility of the situation. The most important trend when you look at the Trump performance, I think, is this. There's a question that has been asked since 1947, very big American audiences, by Gallup, by Rand, and a few others. So we have a really long-term trend here. The question is this. The U.S. should mind its own business internationally and let other countries get along the best they can on their own. In other words, do we opt for isolationism? Do we feel that we should insulate, or do we feel that we should cooperate with the nation? Now, those people who disagree, in other words, who want to work with the world, have dominated for quite a long time. It changed dramatically for a while with Vietnam. It was only after the Persian Gulf War when there was a sense that perhaps we can be allied with other nations, perhaps this is good. The Bush Senior, President Bush Senior, was able to create that united front with other countries, and that had an impact. But it also had another impact through the military. And that was that America can resolve major problems with military, focusing on the military, not so much on other aspects. And that, to many of those who saw Vietnam, was not a healthy trend. And they were concerned that we will get more and more alienation in the future. And I believe in the long run they have been right. Now look at the figures around 2008. This was the time of the great economic crisis. That's when most Americans started feeling, okay, this is it. We've been good for the world. We've been helping the world. The world depends on us. And yet we have been victimized. Why? If you talk with the ordinary Americans, whether they're in Brooklyn, LA, or DC, or Alabama, that's what you're going to hear.
if you ask them, if they're younger, do you think you will do better than your parents? They will say no. And they think that these are two isolated things. I think that they're actually intertwined, because when you try to boost the military and economic capabilities and are so dependent on debt, people will have to pay the bill. And it will weaken the economy and strengthen it. But if you seriously look at these numbers since 2008, Trump did not create this trend. He capitalized on it, he took advantage on it, and he was very smart in doing so. His point was never to win most of the votes in the US. Votes do not matter, electoral college does. And that he won. There was one other candidate who had pretty much the same strategy, and that was Bernie Sanders on the Democratic side. The only one who really represented the people, because if you look at the donations, almost all of his support was based on donations that were less than $20 a piece. If you're an ordinary citizen, that's what you can get. Now, you can represent major think tanks, major organizations, investment banks, real estate associations, traders, then you can put millions onto the table. And that was the case with Mrs. Clinton, that used to be the case with Mr. Obama, that was certainly the case with Mr. Trump, but less so than with other Republican candidates. Sanders tried to do actually the same, but he lost. And he lost partly because of Trump and partly probably because of the Democratic National Leadership Council. What will make the Trump situation so difficult in the US and in G20 is this. He was the first president, not the first president who wanted to reset relations with Russia. If you think about it, go back. Four presidents. Obviously, Bush Jr. wanted to reset the relations with Russia. When he came to office in the early 2000s, he said that we cannot have this kind of animosity between us and Russia. We have to find a way. And then he met Mr. Putin and said that I've seen the soul of Mr. Putin and I think that we can work together. I actually think it was very sincere on his part. Then it became December 11, Putin offered to help. Then came the neoconservatives and things started changing really dramatically. Prior to that, there was, of course, Mr. Clinton. He wanted to reset the relation, but he didn't have too much reason to do so because Russia was weak at the time. He was dealing with Yeltsin. And Yeltsin was very weak physically, psychologically, and the country as a whole economically. There was Obama. President Obama, when he came in, he said, I want to reset relations with Russia. We need to prevent a disaster that would ensue for nuclear proliferation. When Trump came in, he really meant it, the same thing. But when you look back, there's this odd situation that all four presidents have had to give in, have had to compromise. And if we listen to the conservative voices and that are for regime changes, if we listen to the liberal voices that are for liberal internationalism, which some call liberal interventionism, the argument is that because of the way Russia acted in Crimea, this is absolutely necessary. We cannot allow this. The freedom of Eastern Europe depends on us being strong in the region. If you listen to those who are critical of this sort of thinking, the feeling is that the intelligence communities and the military are leading the US policy, not the executive arm. It's a very blatant thesis. I can't stand fully behind it. I understand it. But I do think that we have a situation where four presidents now have changed, wanted to change the situation. Each one has failed. Trump is about to fail. And you have to ask why. And the road, the path leads you back to the intelligence community. Now, we can debate the merits of the case one way or the other. What matters is what does it mean, really? What can Trump do and what can he not do? And there's three ways of looking at it. One is that those parts of his agenda that require legislation, meaning Congress, for instance, tax policy, will not work. He's vulnerable because he doesn't have the Democratic support. There's no way he will get it. And he doesn't even have the full Republican support. Now, the second point is that those areas, such as trade policy, which can be handled mostly through the executive arm, that can work. That can move ahead. And clearly, he's now trying to push it. He needs wins desperately. China knows that he needs wins. Germany knows that he needs short-term wins. But even they are a little bit disinclined to go there. Germany perhaps is hoping that there would be an impeachment at some point. Then he would have to deal with a very different kind of person. China probably thinks that, no, impeachment is not good, but the weaker the US president, the better our negotiating position. That's classic bargaining. The third aspect is the sanctions. That's located somewhere between the two. But that doesn't really separate Mr. Trump from others. He actually wants stronger sanctions against Iran when Democrats are behind the deal that was created during the Obama era, and so are most Republicans. Now, most likely, he will have to sign the new sanctions unless something very odd might happen. And that means that if you look at the past 100 days, his first 100 days, he has achieved the least of all the US presidents since the post-war era. This is something new. And I think that the result of the special counsel's investigation is a no-brainer. It will be that Russia, in some ways, has intervened with the US elections. But when you go to the details, you will be informed that it's a national security matter, and thus we cannot give you the details. And that will be enough to those who believe in that argument, and not to those who don't. I no longer do, and so do not many Americans. But the real issue is that it will complicate the process of Trump in office in a way that his hands will be tied. He thought, for instance, that the situation in Europe is so bad that what will happen in England is that the Conservatives will lose power, the Labour will lose power, but the Independent Party will win. He was wrong. Independents won in the sense that their agenda was co-opted by the Conservatives, which allowed them to keep their position. He thought that in France, Marine Le Pen might have a chance to win, and she did have a chance to win, and she did relatively well. But Macron was the only candidate who had a good relationship with the United States, who was among the youth leaders for the United States. Others were, and he's also the only one that, according to publicized reports in WikiLeaks, has not been investigated by the US intelligence community during the election. All the other presidential candidates from France have. So he was in a better position. Whatever the reasons were, the fact of the matter remains that the leaders now in Europe are not your radical Eurosceptics. There's Macron, who wants to have a very strong Europe, but wants to make concessions. There is UK that will separate, divorce from Europe. Not through hard Brexit, as they say politically, it will be a soft one, but it's a divorce, nonetheless. As to the Eurozone itself, it is now doing better than before, and the perception is, some might say, that the growth is even better than in the US. That won't last. Keep in mind that Europe is constantly printing new money, buying asset purchases, the European Central Bank is doing this, and they will continue to do so until the end of the year, is my guess. They might stop it early next spring. That's when we will find out how strong the European economy really is. I think that their growth, their problems are serious, but unless there's a very disruptive turn, say in Italy, premature elections, or one of the anti-system parties might win, then we might see a real turn in about things. The more troublesome thing is, on the right-hand side, the lingering structural crises. Most of them remain. They haven't been resolved. Now, I, coming from the economic side, look very much at R&D competitiveness, no change. China is putting now more money on R&D per GDP than Europe. The longer that continues, there will be more and more questions, where is European productivity heading? It will not grow fast unless it becomes more competitive. And they are cutting R&D budgets, not enhancing those. All this in the name of austerity. We can come back to other countries later if need be. In the case of Japan, I felt after the first 3 to 6 months of Shinzo Abe that Abenomics would fail. And I'm on record on this. And I say sadly, because there was a real effort for change, I believe. I'm not so crazy about his foreign policy, because I think that it's antagonistic, and I'm not sure that he should put money into military in Japan, particularly when they have an aging demographics and a very difficult economic situation. But it's understandable in terms of history and his background, certainly. But what is really important was his objective, which was to have 2% inflation by the end of his term. And as a result, they injected so much money, printed money, and are still doing it. The amount of money they are printing per month is comparable to what the Fed, US Federal Reserve, did in the middle of the crisis, 2009, but three times it, each month. But what's the result? What's the payback? If you look at those pictures, that tells us, particularly the Bank of Japan's projections. The target was 2%, which was supposed to happen by now. The reality is almost close to zero. You need to reflate to create some sense of economic activity, some sense of growth, and that hasn't worked. And it hasn't worked despite all of these efforts. And that is very, very troublesome. So I think that right now we're seeing in Japan a situation where perhaps their role is beginning to change in terms of the opposition voices become stronger and so on and so forth. But the political consolidation that Mr. Abe has, it has been very strong at least until now. Nonetheless, their growth level will be less than 1% in a matter of 5 years, and then it will continue to go down with the aging demographic unless there are far more impactful changes. Then China. Before I came here, we talked a little bit about China, and I mentioned that whenever I go to China and have been in Europe or US, I'm always concerned. It looks so bad when I look at the papers. Then I'm in China, I'm there a month or two, and I come out sort of relaxed. You know, well, it's kind of could be better, but it's not really bad. If you want to get your place on Saturday, you go to eat out, you have to fight for it. Restaurants are full. If you want to buy an apartment, not so easy. But notice it's harder to sell an apartment nowadays. I think things are changing in China. And I can inform you about the fact that they really started changing this May. Now we know that last May, the change that most people thought would happen with the party congress in the fall already was made. The People's Bank of China started monetary tightening. And that's something new. When you allow less liquidity into the economy, not as much as other countries would like China to do, but significantly now, to the degree that my dear friend Mr. Rubini is saying that this may create a backlash. When you try to do so much tightening so fast, this may actually, the money flows may shrink. It may be actually problematic to China. I don't think we are there, but I was intrigued by the fact that this happened already before the fall. Xi Jinping needs political consensus, a political mandate to push reforms. And he has been for the monetary tightening, I believe, for about a year. There have been sort of authoritative voices in People's Daily and other important dailies in China indicating that the present line is not okay. And it was not okay for a simple reason. China was taking debt twice as fast as it was growing. You can do it some of the time. Most countries have done it some of the time, especially during the crisis, but you cannot do it very long. It will undermine your economy in the long run. If you look at the situation right now, I tend to feel a bit conservative about China, but nonetheless, I see growth of 6 to 6.5% by the end of this year. And unless there's major military strategic disruption in the region, growth 5% by early 20s. It's going down, it's decelerating, but so it should. No country can industrialize forever. The industrialization always creates a very rapid spurt. We saw that in Europe after the war, 1945 to early 1970s. Italy was growing by 7%. Mention a European country that can do the same right now. There's none. They're glad if they can do 1 to 2%. But like Nordics, that's considered to be very good. And one mention about another big country, which would be Russia, because it's kind of intriguing. And today we heard that about 755 Americans will have to leave Moscow, and their compounds are now also threatened over there, just as the Russian compound has been threatened in D.C. This was precisely what Mr. Trump did not want to happen. So there's a huge fight for, let's say, the soul of America behind the facade. And we don't know how it will turn out to be. If you look at those two figures on the right-hand side, the argument when the sanctions were created was that, well, that will kill the support of President Putin. The people will say, what are you doing to us economically? You are hurting us. He will be voted out, or there will be so much opposition, or there will be popular discontent translated to a regime change that he will have to leave his office. And we won't suffer so much. And yet when you look at the trade figures, Americans doing trade with Russia or Europeans doing trade, all of those figures have plunged. Americans are hurt, but not that much. But Europeans are. They need to recover. And this will hurt them not just because of trade and investment, but because of energy trade and all the strategies that are associated with that. The other surprise to those who don't understand Russia is that the people are now united behind Putin. It was the sanctions that united Russians behind him. I've talked with so many Russians in the past 5 years. If you talk with those who are conservative, they say that I used to be conservative centrist, center to right. Now I think that we need tougher measures. We have to fight America. If you talk with those who were sort of center left, they will say, I joined the Communist Party. You once gave your card back, why would you join them? Well, I think that you cannot discuss with America. I think that, unfortunately, you have to be tough to deal with them. They are trying to destabilize our nation the second time. And that's unacceptable. So you see this discontent creating a united front. We don't know how long it will last, because people will be hurting more economically. But the middle class has already been hurt. I do want to remind you that, as far as I'm concerned, it was the Russians who spared the Europe in the Second World War. It was the sacrifice of millions of people. There is a very strong determination in that country and their people, a patriotism, a sense of patriotism, and you should never, never underestimate it. And you should never think that ideas such as your motherland, what you believe in, are for sale. They have not forgotten what happened in the 1990s when Russia went on its knees. And uncles and people simply ended up in poverty. After they were told that you will have big bang democracy, you will have overnight, we will change the institutions, translation, the oligarchs got them. Public assets were looted. You will have well-being, translation, 30% poverty, and so on and so forth. What Putin did in the beginning, he restored a lot of the economic strength. Russia is no longer indebted to US, to Europe as well, and for a reason. But naturally, the situation is now very uncomfortable. If it wasn't for the sanctions, now the third round, Russia would actually be rising from its downturn relatively fast. But this will unfortunately slow down. And the question is, does it translate to ordinary Russians and their well-being and to what degree, and how will they process? So what about then the G20 IDAS? If these are the countries that have the key role in driving those items, one of the key areas is globalization and daily trade. Here you have the Baltic Dry Index, which is being used by many analysts to measure international trade, particularly international commodity trade, say ships coming from Asia going to Africa, and so on and so forth. At the peak, it was almost 12,000 points. Then it fell to 666. Devilish numbers from the Bible, right after the crisis. Now, the US stock market, since its plunge, has grown up to close to 18,000 or so, even further than that at times. But if you use the logic of this US stock market and think that, well, when the US economy is recovering, shouldn't this as well, if it reflects world economy, the US has had such a great role. What constantly surprises me that it's around 1,000. It's not 11, it's not 10, it's not 9, it's not 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 2, 3, 2. It has barely been 2 at any point of time. And that means that there's something seriously wrong. It's a warning signal. What about then globalization overall, as we measure it? And we usually measure it by trade, investment, and migration. The great years of globalization in this sense were from 1870s to 1940s. People barely had passports, which is hard to remember nowadays. I like to read biographies from that era because that was the era of industrialization in the East to Western Europe. When you moved from one country to another, passport was not your first consideration. It was still a mess. You were dealing with empires, not democracies. And one good thing about it was that migration was mobile. People could move from one country to another relatively easy. So if people were needed in England because of economic reasons, doors were open. Now it's the reverse. And this is something that has really hit Philippines through Saudi Arabia. And it's bound to hit Philippines through the illegal immigration first in the United States and then the legal because of the immigration policies of the Trump administration. There was that huge plunge from 1917 or the First World War to the end of Second World War. Then the creation of the Bretton Woods institutions, the new rise of the international trade first in the West, and after 1980s in Asia and emerging economies. And now it's changing. the steady increase in trade, investment, and migration is gone. The steady growth is gone. We are not yet even where we were kind of around 2008. And this is extremely worrisome. If you look at the studies of world trade, we see that this sort of started around 2015. And there are economic, strategic, political, all kinds of reasons for that. One reason is also that G20 countries, maybe four or five, started directing more and more protectionist barriers against trade. And when G20 countries do that and they have such a central role in world economy, it's particularly bad. So world trade has not increased, it has plateaued, it's barely breathing. Despite ultra-low interest rates, despite asset purchases, so through monetary means and fiscal means, far more has been done in world economy than at any point of time since 1945, and none of this has worked. Trade is like a patient who doesn't know should he be alive or dead. If you look at investment, it tells us that there are some increases now, but if you look at the absolute levels, they're still behind what was the case around 2007 and 8. So we're still trying to get to the starting point where we were 10 years ago. We're not moving ahead. We're running in place and thinking that we are moving. And honestly, think about 1930s, the years of fascism, Stalinism, and all these extremist movements in Europe. There was actually a fair amount of investment then. You didn't have an alternative. If you were an American oil company and you wanted to compete in Europe, you couldn't trade so much because there were already barriers. So you invested more in those countries, and you prayed God that there would not be a war, because then you would lose your properties, which is precisely what happened by 1939. So investment doesn't mean that even if it decreases, that the macro conditions are getting better. It may actually mean that they're getting worse. Because now CEOs think that maybe I should invest more there, because what guarantees do I have that I can't export in the future? And unfortunately, I hear this more and more when I talk with executives. And then particularly the situation with migration, we see a situation that at the time when the advanced economies are aging, and are maturing, at the time when they need most migration, they are creating the most obstacles against it. I'm not one of those who has ever supported this. And I think that the Europeans are absolutely foolish in this. And Americans are becoming equally foolish in this. And Japanese have always been foolish about that. And I think that they are just trying to defend their own interests and think that they can do so by doing this. In the future, in 10, 20 years, they will have to start paying for migrants to come in. That's a simple reality. But this is what it is right now. And what is equally troublesome, but totally understandable in terms of the migration decline, is the fact that the global displacement is now at the level that's highest since war years. 65 million people displaced. That is massive. And we don't see it in Europe, if I take my European hat, because we didn't see it until recently. There were no migrants coming from North Africa dying on the boat trying to get to Italy. In Italy, the executive arm is trying to negotiate with Macron, basically pleading, praying, can you take some? And he's looking the other way, hoping that the problem will go away. Merkel is opening the doors, but for an understandable reason, Germans need more workers. And I think that's ultimately the reason why. There are very cynical considerations behind all of this, but it creates tragedies. And I think that, you know, when we talk about economy, and let's say most of you have heard about the notion of multiplier, the idea being that, well, if the government puts money and you live on a budget deficit, like we're doing here in the Philippines with the infrastructure, as we should, that money then multiplies when it is being injected to the economy. It's the same with drones. If you use drones and you use them in Pakistan and they go to the wrong place, and instead of the target, you kill about 50, 20, 30 civilians, they will hate you. You killed my mother, you killed my father, I will never forgive this. I will come back to you. And the fear about this is that it's creating comparable issues. Now, from the US point of view, and this was the reason why G20 was so, there was so much friction, conflict within it. The American point of view is that we have been victimized. We've been hurt by globalization. We're doing everything right. We are offering you free trade, and yet you have used us. And yet there are more complicated reasons behind it. If you look at the right-hand side, the U.S. corporate tax rate, now there Mr. Trump is right, is relatively highest currently in the United States. And that naturally creates an incentive for companies to go out. Mr. Trump thinks that he can make them come back. Won't happen. As long as they can park their money into tax paradises, which is the case right now. That you can't do in Europe. So this is not a European problem. European companies overall pay their taxes and are more responsible in that sense than American companies. Now he's changed that what he wants to do is to halve his corporate rate, which is 39 and more, down to 15%. That would be less than Singapore or Hong Kong. And he thinks that he would then get two things. American companies, A, would bring their profits back to the U.S., invest in America, as he says. And he thinks times are working for this because prices are getting higher in China and perhaps in other emerging economies as well. He's a bit too optimistic about that. China is not the only emerging economy in Asia, as we know. But he also thinks that those companies will move their major operation back to the U.S., not just their money, but they will create more physical stock in America. But I'm afraid that this won't be enough, and the reason is that it will not get rid of the trade deficit America has. America didn't have deficits until early 70s. America was the world factory. America was the China of the times, because it could. That changed in the early 70s partly because of Japan at first. So now you have deficits with China, with Japan. As we go to 80s, then the countries that Japan was using. Japan is getting too pricey, so it starts offshoring. It goes to Hong Kong, Taiwan, Singapore, South Korea, countries that Europeans had heard nothing about until the first transistor radios came not from Japan, but came from Korea. Now these countries have a deficit with the United States. And then when China starts rising, starts its reforms, 1990s, and particularly when China joins the World Trade Organization in 2001, they really escalate. And trust me, when they end with China, they will start with India, then they will start with ASEAN. And here you will have tough negotiations with the US as well. So it's not a bilateral thing, which has been the US doctrine for quite a long time. It's a multilateral thing. It's between several countries and those who are at a certain point of development. And it's a regional thing. It's between North America, US, primarily to a degree, Canada, with Asia, as long as Asia depends on low cost. But this creates a conflict within the trade policy of America, within its new protectionism. When you create a trade policy based on deficit targeting, those countries with whom I have a deficit are the problem. Germany's a problem, China's a problem, etc., etc. They are also the countries that invest a lot in America. Here are the investment numbers from quite recent. And what you find immediately, that most of the stock, investment stock in America comes from Europe. That Trump is now doing his best to alienate. This is untenable, and that's, I think, because the view of the trade policy in America right now is that all it means is trade. But that's not all it means. It means trade, it means investment policies, it's technology policies, it's financial policies. The British wanted to get rid of the EU. Now they realize that all banks are moving to Europe. Why should they be in the UK if it's not part of the EU? You came to UK because you got two things. You got to be part of the EU, and you benefited from relatively lax British laws. But if you have to choose, you go to Europe. So trade policies are far more complicated than people have thought. The alternative that's left then is what some people have called China-led globalization. I beg to disagree. I think that there are countries that lead globalization, but it's not like America has given up globalization, and it won't happen. Trust me. And after Trump, there will be somebody who will not have his policy line. There's more continuity. But Trump really reflects a long-term reaction within the US. And we now see what happens when it goes a bit further. So at the same time, we see the situation in China. China is supporting this own or One Belt, One Road system. Those who happen to be here previous times when I was speaking know that this was my greatest concern. What if Philippines falls behind this plan? Philippines wants to build infrastructure. Philippines wants to industrialize. Philippines needs capital, and so on and so forth. China wants to export capital. China wants to export its wares. China could conceivably sell cheap certain equipment that the West might call dumping, but that might be actually helpful in many modernizing economies. So there is a kind of a marriage, potential marriage, that happened between Brazil and China about 10, 15 years ago. Both could benefit if both stay tough in the negotiations. Because for the Chinese, this is business, it's not philanthropy. For US, it was ideology and business. Now we are in a different situation when it comes to the Philippines point of view, but the role of OBOR is extremely important for the following reason, and that's I tried to sort of reflect it with this little figure. The Marshall Plan, if you calculate in terms of modern dollars, would today be worth $130 billion. The OBOR would be 4 to 8 trillion. Now, Marshall Plan was 4 years. OBOR, I would argue, 3 to 4 decades, perhaps. At least 2. So, very different approaches. And we honestly don't know how OBOR will work. Some people say that China is taking so much debt, this is risky, this is very problematic. The leader of Pakistan was overthrown by the Supreme Court. China has put a lot of money in Pakistan. I personally doubt whether some of that money will ever come back. But if it works, it will also stabilize Pakistan. There is an understanding in China and many other emerging economies that what is so, so very important is that people have a stake in the country where they live. What did the Singaporeans do the first thing when they created their own country? They had a hard time getting rid of the corruption, dirt, crime, all the things that were no longer associated with Singapore. Now it looks so clean and pretty and expensive and all of those things. But that was the real job. And one of the first things they did was public housing. Lee Kuan Yew understood it very well. Why would you defend a country that you have no stake in? Those words do not only apply in Asia, they apply in Harlem. The reason many people fight back, whether it's black power or heroin or whatever it might be, is that I don't feel this country is committed to me. What it owes nothing to me, I owe nothing to it. So be it. We are at war. There's this feeling in China that if you can create circumstances where the living standards would go to the level of $10,000-$15,000 per capita, people have a stake in their future. If I have a house and a mortgage, before I might have been a bad boy, I might rebel, I might fight in the streets. Now, mortgage. I can't do that. I can't be in prison. That's bad for business. You know, I have a shore, I have a store, and so on and so forth. So, if you don't have that economic development, you have nothing. Another aspect that was so problematic in G20 is the climate change. Here are two examples from one of the leading German magazines about how they feel about Trump policies and what Trump represents. One has Trump playing golf and kicking out the globe. The other one is basically Trump as a fireball approaching the Earth. So the scorched earth policy with a new meaning. If we look at this and the global climate change, one of the most intriguing aspects of that, I believe, is that if I go to the US and Europe, the world nowadays is that China and India are the greatest polluters. They create so much problems to us. And as a result, there should be a change in terms of this kind of negative impact on climate change. But what happened in Europe was exactly the same. With European industrialization, you had massive forces of child labor in Europe, especially in the UK. And the argument of the executives at the time, which were really sort of hustlers, little business owners, was that it's cheaper to have little kids. Charles Dickens told the story. It's cheaper to have them because you don't really need to know too much. If you have a big company, you have very simple tasks. A kid can do what the adult can do. I'm not responsible for his future. He's labor force. He works for me. That's capitalism to you. So you had this labor force. You had one of the worst ecological situations in London. The good news in terms of history, you did not have CNN, you did not have Asian News, you had no coverage, you had no CCTV telling people how terrible it was and you shouldn't do this. But you had British reformers. You had John Stuart Mill and others who started creating laws, 1830s, 50s, and 80s. And this started to change very, very slowly. Now the same situation is in Asia. And it's in all those emerging countries where the industrialization is most intensive. Actually, China is now fading out from that category. India is coming in. 5 years ago, all my American friends were always bitching about the pollution in China, and it was really bad, and it still is, if you go to Beijing. Shanghai, you can see already some of the change, Guangzhou even more in Guangdong. And the change is now sort of becoming more pervasive. But the little known secret was that almost all major Indian cities had it worse. But there was not so much stories about that. My Chinese friends said, well, they work with Americans, so that's why, and they are American-controlled media. Partly yes, but I don't think that they simply knew enough of India at the time. It was part being sloppy reporting, partly ignorance, and partly geopolitics, if you will. What we do know that there are certain phenomena that come with the global climate change that are so detrimental, particularly the global warming and carbon dioxide concentration. I kept in touch with Mr. Hansen, who was the first American who testified in Congress about climate change in 1988, and who is still active in these cases. And I contacted him because I felt that the official limitations that we have, not more than 2 Celsius increase in the next 50, 100 years. I looked at my data, and there's no way we will have that, and we'll have it worse. So I thought, why not ask the best authority? And he said, of course we will. This is all facade. From his point, he went to Paris, a climate meeting. He walked out after a while, because he felt that it was a facade, and it doesn't create really binding commitments. He feels that there has to be a worse crisis before something really happens. So he's expecting a crisis for actions. So why is this the case? And what is important to understand about it? When we look at the global climate change, it has to do with unequal footprints. Industrialized nations and those who have already industrialized, advanced economies, they created accumulated pollution and have done so, maybe 2 centuries. China, India, now Philippines are new players, and they will have the same role. You need that kind of intensive, energy-intensive industrialization in the early stage of industrialization. But that means that when you look at pollution here in terms of oil, GDP per capita, you will find very quickly that although in aggregate terms, China and India are the greatest polluters perhaps nowadays, it is still the advanced economies, especially those that trust very much laissez-faire ideas, US, Australia, Canada, and a few others, that are the biggest polluters at the GDP per capita level. And I think you really have to look at it at that level. If you want to be serious about human rights and think that every human being has importance, then you cannot look just aggregate figures, because that would mean that your people are 5 times more important because you live in the West. And perhaps you created these protectionist barriers because you don't want to share that wealth. And perhaps you actually want to keep that level of pollution and so on and so forth. So there's a clear distinction between the advanced economies that have the greatest riches and have the highest polluters at the per capita level still. Now, if you look at what has happened in this regard, I think some of the best studies have been done by German Watch, a think tank focusing on these matters, and I will just mention them briefly. But what is distressing is that when you look at the climate change performance index, in other words, the countries that are trying to do something to change this, US is way behind where it should be. When you have America behind Japan, Russia Federation, Korea, and barely ahead of Saudi Arabia, there's a problem. This was not the case in the post-war era. This was not the case, I think, until the 70s. But then, a lot of things changed in the West. And in terms of military strength, in terms of energy use, and so on and so forth. There was a moment of time when people felt, especially under Carter administration, that you need major energy reforms, but you never had enough political consensus behind it. You had actually the reverse view. Today, the Energy Department in the US is led by a person who, before the elections, wanted to dismantle the entire department. And that sort of tells you where we are at. It doesn't mean that we're dealing with irrational people, that people who really want bad things to everybody. It has to do with the fact that I think they are oriented mainly by economic incentives, and they think that this is manageable in the long run. But as a result, when they look at the situation from the point of view of emissions level, energy use, renewables, climate policy, the United States has lost its leading position heading this movement. So to blame Trump for the policy shift in America would be a big mistake. To blame Obama would be a big mistake. I think he really wanted to change this, but he was an ineffective president, simply put. The underlying trend in America is very clear. If you look at the population, most people want to support climate change. American cities are solidly behind it. There is an independence movement in California that wants to be independent from America that has based a case entirely on this. They won't become independent, but it reflects something. We're not happy with what's happening in DC. But when we look at it from the emerging market point of view, in other words, from the point of view of the G10, those 10 that are not advanced, including the Philippines, that's not part of G20 now, but might, as I said earlier, might be part of it by 2050, if you do things right. The problem is that you will have to then deal with the legacy of those governments, those administrations, those countries that focus on their own interests primarily. And that means that the catastrophic risk, which used to be theoretical 10, 15 years ago, is now becoming quite viable. And it also means, quite ironically, that those countries that have the lowest GDP per capita will have the highest losses in terms of their GDP. In reverse, advanced economies, in other words, those countries with the relatively higher GDP per capita will have lower losses. I have absolutely no doubt that some of the people supporting the Trump administration, especially certain financiers, and some of who don't support him, like the Koch brothers, their idea is that so what? We are making good money on this. We have a shale gas revolution. We can benefit from this. So why don't we do this? Because our losses will be a lot less than those of other people. So in relative terms, we are actually gaining ground. Others are falling us behind. We are dealing with the transition, and that's the second figure. That's about 10 to 20 years, because as China is now actually, if you look at the growth rate, though, it's in energy-intensive industrialization, it's becoming lower. It's still very high, but the rate is low, becoming lower, or the absolute level is still going up. India, becoming more intense because of industrialization. So will Philippines. And that's why you have this very strange situation where China, 10 years ago I said somewhere that based on my experiences and my data, China is becoming the pioneer of the fight against climate change. And it's kind of funny when you're being laughed out from every European event, every American event. And always after the laughter, I said, I will come back here 10 years from now and I will hold you, I will hold you for your words now, because it will happen. You are in a situation where you're opening a coal factory today while you're opening a factory for renewables. You have to do the both, you say. If I talk with my friend Mr. Hansen, he says you don't. There are alternatives, but then you won't grow as fast, and then so many people can't be taken out from poverty as fast. If you look at the climate risk, and this is my greatest concern, especially when it comes to Philippines, on the left-hand side you have the negative impact as measured by various indicators, death toll, death per 100,000 inhabitants, absolute losses, losses per unit, human development index, so on and so forth. 2015, on the right-hand side, there is a 10-year, actually 20-year scale from 1996 to 2015. Philippines is close to the, it's not just in top 10, but top 5. So, if global climate change is not at the very center of the fight in G20, and let's say that Philippines could actually become a G20 nation by 2050, we are dealing with a massive legacy, myself included, because I plan to be here a long time. Massive legacy that will be terrible for our kids. Sometimes when I go to China, I have to sort of try to make this real for myself. We had a clinic where my wife, I had to go with my wife. She had an ailment at the time. Next to that, there was a factory town. And I talked to the people and asked how many, the parts of carbon dioxide in the air, and because I was always coughing leading it. Where I heard the numbers, I calculated that the average or the predictable life expectancy for those kids would be probably 45, 50 years. So when I looked at them dancing, playing outside, I saw in front of me an old engraving from the Middle Ages in Europe where we had skeletons dancing. It's something that we have to think very carefully. Do we have to have a lot of people who are doing well Do we want to have few people that do well at the expense of others? Or do we have to be in a sort of intermediate position where, yes, everybody will be better off, but will die younger? These are terrible trade-offs. And don't think that the Chinese aren't thinking about them. They deal with them on a daily basis. What are the other issues then that sort of are creating new kind of breaches or new kind of conflicts within the G20? I will mention very quickly a few. The most recent one, honestly, still a surprise to me. I wrote my first piece as a commentary on the theme, United States as a Global Risk, already last year, mid-year, and I thought that this is, I hate myself for doing it, I'm a little bit ashamed. But at the same time, I thought that it's only fair to warn about this because the elections in America may be very different from the expectations. But now, according to the Fragile States Index, that's the case. The U.S. is a global risk. Now, taking into consideration the very important point of the U.S. economy in the global economy and in the G20, that means something very, very important. Then it's no longer funny. The second point, when we look at the fiscal policy, we are in a situation where the advanced economies that have lived through austerity, to some degree at least, are now coming out from the crisis, shrinking to a degree. The livelihoods are not moving very fast ahead. Some countries that will remain behind for decades, like Greece and a few others, Southern Europe. France is not so far from that, to be honest. Italy is very close to that still. But nonetheless, the growth will be around 2%, 1 to 2% for years and years to come. Emerging economies, where the growth will still be 2 to 3 times faster. So when the bottom line is very clear, the interest, in some sense, of the G20 countries, I would say, but the interests of the advanced and emerging economies have not changed. They are different. They are different in the sense that they are based on different trajectories. But if the trade suffers in the advanced economies, it will hurt the emerging economies. When I couldn't buy electronics in the center of Manhattan, mid-Manhattan, in the fall of 2008, because all the electronic discounters were close to bankruptcy, and I went back to China, I noticed that the factories in Guangdong were relatively empty. Container ships were standing in front of Singapore, hundreds of them. I've never seen anything like that. Hundreds of container ships doing nothing. Can you imagine how expensive that is? And the result was very concrete. I would go to China, I would go to Thailand. People had been fired for the companies that they worked with because there was no demand. So trade, employment, manufacturing, it's all intertwined in that sense. Then the monetary policy. Americans, Europeans, Japanese have been easing in a way that we've never seen before. We have no precedent. We don't know what this means in the long term. We are now moving from monetary easing to monetary tightening, but this is a symmetric move. Things will just change upside down. So if one was easing, the tightening was this. If in that era we bought assets, now we won't. What does it mean? Bank of Japan has bought the majority position in most Nikkei 225 stock companies. What does that mean? They're no longer, it's not laissez-faire environment anymore. Trading companies are owned by their stakes. Stock is owned by their central banks. What does this mean? Bonds are not available as they used to be. Equity markets have been distorted by this. We have no previous experience, time will tell. What we do know is that America is now exiting. Europe will join in by next spring. Japan claims that it would like and might. Won't happen, I think, until the end of this decade, perhaps earliest 2020s. But emerging economies are beginning their tightening only now because of this. Mention examples from history when advanced economies and emerging economies were both tightening at the same time. There was no liquidity available. It's very hard to find those. Add the consideration, there have been moments where there has been at least 700 interest rate cuts, which has now been the case in advanced economies, and major asset purchases so that the central banks of the West own collectively about $12 trillion worth of assets. No examples in history. So we have no clear ideas how this might turn out. What about global imbalances? Now, this was the idea. This was the issue that came up in Hamburg, steel. And the reason is that when you look at global imbalances, China has a major surplus, which has, by the way, Germany. And America doesn't. America has a deficit. And since you are creating in the US trade policy based on deficit targeting, this is a great problem. And this illustrates the distortions that the emerging economies or advanced economies like Germany and others that are export promoting create in our economy. Now, the Chinese side is saying, and some others, that this is not the only imbalance we have. Look at the role of dollar. In the post-war era, dollar dominated the worldwide. In the 50s, 60s, or at less. Now US as an economy is about 20-25% of the total. That's actually a great achievement for a single nation. No other nation has been able to do that. And you have to only appreciate that. If it's based on the inherent strength of the economy rather than regime changes in other nations. But if you look at the currency weights according to the IMF International Basket, dollar is about 42%, which is not so far from its present importance in the world economy, although if you use other indicators, it might be about 60%, really. So you have, as my Chinese friends would say, isn't this a curious situation? US economy has only 20% of the total in the fundamentals. It's an economy that's in debt for more than the size of the economy itself, so it's in a fragile position. And they hold 40% of the institutional portfolios worldwide, or actually more, international portfolios. Isn't this dangerous? Now, the Chinese are saying this because they want to internationalize the renminbi. They want to be part of those portfolios. That's for granted, but they do make a point. What was so strange about this steel issue was the following. When Trump went to, or if you remember the summit with Xi Jinping and Trump in early April, there was the idea that they created a 100-day action plan. The idea was to create a reasonable progress in trade so that both parties would, move ahead. 2 weeks after that meeting, not after 100 days, but 2 weeks after that meeting, Trump issued a presidential memorandum that directed the Commerce Secretary, Wilbur Ross, to look and create a report, investigate the effects of steel on national security. 2 weeks after. So that has been an ongoing process. Right before the Chinese-US Comprehensive Economic Dialogue, which we now call CED, Trump made a statement, they are dumping steel and destroying our steel industry. And Ross said, in a closed meeting in Senate, that he would present Trump options to restrict steel imports on national security grounds soon. And he made that explicit sometime later. So now you have a curious situation. Chinese are getting uneasy, but so are Europeans. Because Europeans are actually, while China is the biggest producer, the Europeans are the biggest exporters in the United States. If you look at the US steel import shares by country, China is not even in the top 10. They import less than 2% of steel in the US. But Trump sort of directed all his wrath against China. Honestly, he was really talking to Merkel. What happened then in June, while some people were vacationing in US and Europe, the European NATO leaders and the European President Prime Ministers wanted to have an audience with the Defense Secretary James Mattis of the United States. They dragged him into this debate. They said, how on earth can he attack us on steel and make this a national security issue? Mattis, being a decent man, probably said, I have no idea, I have to talk with Washington, D.C. So he delegated all the issues to D.C. The Europeans were concerned because there was another issue, and now it's steel, that will become an issue for NATO, and that will become an issue in G20. And Chinese are saying, my God, why are you approaching us? We don't even bring steel into your market. But China does bring 50% of the world production nowadays, which is about the same as US, Japan, and Europe did 10, 20 years ago. Then nobody talked about these things negatively because nobody wanted to irritate the G7. Unfortunately, this is only the beginning. It starts with steel, but next in the agenda, you have aluminum, semiconductors, paper, household appliances. So China's turn will come, not just in steel. And NATO will be an issue. With this process, you have also a curious situation in the Middle East. And I mention Middle East because if you remember the migration slide, most of the migration, most of the violence, terrorist violence, most of the destabilization happens in the Middle East. And it's changing. There's a massive shift that started around 2011 and 12 when Saudi Arabia's biggest supplier became, or buyer became China, no any longer the United States. US had created this relation, this alliance, already in the 1930s, and at the time disrupted the British negotiations with Saudi Arabia, created a preferential relationship. So when President Roosevelt went to Yalta to divide Europe, basically with Stalin and Churchill and so on and so forth, right after that meeting, he rushed to, close to Egypt to have a meeting with the King Saud. And the idea was to ensure that there will be oil for the US economy. Not yet, because the US was exporter, but they knew that the US would become an importer by the 60s. And they wanted to have this close relationship with Saudi Arabia. That is now fragmented. The shale gas revolution in the US meant that Saudis are actually trying to cut the pricing, because they know that they can produce oil and make some profit, even if the price goes down to $20-$30. And they were hoping that American companies would go bankrupt. Many went, but the American economy doesn't work that way. They fired the people and suspended activities, but they didn't declare bankruptcy. So they are actually waiting how long Saudi Arabia can play this game. Because as long as it can, it would hurt their profits, so US will not produce to that extent. But the moment Saudi changes its policy, so will the US. Meanwhile, the Filipinos who are working there in construction or elsewhere, they take the hit. Because Saudi say, well, I can't hire you. I don't have a project. You know how it is. And the Filipinos come home, try to find a job here. And they're not alone. There's quite a few of these people now trying to find a new life. And that creates another problem. 5 years ago, I had this slide on the right-hand side. I was lecturing about it in China, and I was arguing that we are dealing with a major terrorism wave that will start soon after operations in Syria and Iraq start to fade out. And the reason is, remember the drone example that I used, the drone multiplier. When these people go to war theaters, or civil war theaters, they may go as somewhat idealistic, which is hard to understand for many, but that's what they believe in. They fight. When they come back, that means that they didn't die. Point two, if they come back, some of them want to have nothing to do with terrorism, absolutely nothing. I want to have a life, I want to have kids, I've seen enough war and destruction, not for me. Others say, I saw enough. I want to kill. I didn't know it was like this. I didn't know how they would act, how they killed my friends, what happened, really. Now they know how to use firearms, explosives, or they have military knowledge, logistics, and so on and so forth. They will start coming back home. The good news from the Southeast Asian point of view is that the numbers in these groups at the time was around 500, the lowest relative in terms of other regions. The bad news is that Asia is growing. It's good for drugs, it's good for terrorism, because you want to have high profile media stories that terrorism is involved in. So there were two or three groups that were involved that then were looking for a place in Southeast Asia. When I did the same lecture here in the Philippines, I said that when they will come to Mindanao. And somebody asked why. I said, look at the GDP per capita differences. Massive income polarization, where in Metro Manila you can earn 17 times more on average than in Mindanao. Different language, different customs, different religion. I said that, honestly, if I was a young man in Mindanao, I would be very angry. I was not one of those when I was younger who would take it all with stride. I would be angry and I would rebel, or I would try to use official ways, and if they don't work, I'll use others. And there will be others who will use the violence. Now, the fact that the violence hasn't existed on the ground for so long, I think, is really a source of great comfort. It testifies to the fact that the people of Mindanao really have a great faith in the future of the nation, despite their role in the nation. But that role has to have more equity. Absolutely has to. The people who are now coming from these theaters to that area, I know exactly what they will do. Because I saw it in Lebanon in 1970s. I saw it in the first terrorist attacks in the city of Tel Aviv. My first was in Jerusalem in 1934. There was a refrigerator in Beni Huna Street, and somebody put a bomb inside. At the time, people didn't know about these things too much. They exploded. You had 20, 30 people immediately dead, body parts all over the place, blood running through the streets. And gradually, people became tougher and more brutalized with all of that and wanted to have tougher solutions. That leads nowhere, honestly. So, it happened in Lebanon, it happened in Jordan. That's what they're trying to do in Mindanao. So the only good thing one can do is to immediately zoom into the situation, try to contain it, try to kill it while it's still young and relatively meaningless, and try to allow it not to spread. Because the moment that happens, then you have to deal with a whole set of other issues and more resentment. Anybody who gets hurt will have resentment, even if it's for the so-called good cause. When the government tries to use bombs to get rid of the enemy, naturally civilians will die as well. Now, you may actually create more enemies that way, but you deal with very difficult trade-offs. You have to make difficult decisions today to have a better future. So, with the terrorism is intertwined with the migration policies in this very complicated way. There was another issue that was about to happen, and will happen more and more, and that's the NATO friction. Americans say that you are not paying your dues, and Europeans are saying that, well, we're dying on debt. You know, we have to go out via democratic governance. People don't want to pay so much. Now, Americans honestly didn't talk too much about this as long as they had money to cover it on their own, because it gave them a mandate to decide most of the things on their own. If you don't pay, then we think you're more in decision-making. And I think Europeans wanted to have it both ways, so did Japan. You support us, we don't want to pay for it. That, I think, is something where Trump and anybody who thinks the same way is right. But then it becomes a question. Does it mean that you want to change the entire NATO? It should be to allow it to disintegrate. I'm sure that if Trump could decide, he would allow this. You pay, you play. That's the way he thinks. What does it mean in Asia? Does it mean that you would really force Korea to pay more, Japan to pay more, that you would sort of outsource your own international security this way? That's something we will see in the coming months. And then there was the issue of the new Cold War, the fears that a very assertive foreign policy could take us deeper into this. This happened already in the Obama era, but the roots go back to the early 1990s when then one of the heads of Pentagon, policy planners, Walt Forbes, who then became one of the key players during the Iraq War, wrote a policy planning report that was based on the idea of unilateral, U.S. unilateral power worldwide, and that the neoconservatives have been pushing ever since, and which follows that the Russia should disintegrate. It should be maybe four or five entities that is easier for us to control. And it leaves countries, rogue states like North Korea. How to deal with them if you don't have the G20 unanimity, sort of a unanimous decision how to deal with it. You may agree that yes, we should do something about it, but if you differ so much in terms of activities, nothing really will happen. So finally, to end, where does this leave us? If you look at the US and you look at their economic situation, wars, terrorism, conflicts, America can deal with this because it's a huge economy. It will constantly lose a fair amount of money that's conceivable from this in terms of the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. They are a relatively small part of the story, the highest layer there. But it's really these tax cuts that have been done in the US in the past, since 1980, since the Reagan administration, that are creating the very basis of American civil society that I think is the problem. The Mueller investigation will only focus on the Russia issues, but it will complicate the activities and the proactivity of the Trump administration, so it has to move slow, it can't move fast. We will see more and more trade friction, it's almost inevitable, but we will see also more and more friction within the administration. One of the most interesting things here is that Steve Bannon, the radical right supporter of Mr. Trump, his advisor in the White House, he wants to change this. He wants to have progressive taxation in America. He would like to have the highest tax rate up to 44%. Trump is strongly against that. Bannon talks for the poor white middle class in America. If you know about history, when Eisenhower was president in the 1950s, he felt that the richest Americans should naturally pay 95% taxes, like the Swedes are paying nowadays. If you make more money, you didn't make the money on your own. Others supported you, you had workers, you owe it to the society. And Eisenhower was a five-star general and a Republican. So times are now very different in that regard. Then we have the EU scenario, which is far more complex. What we know now is that Europe economically is resilient enough, but it will not be very strong, integrated ended anymore. It will be a post-Brexit Europe. That means, in this picture, I use some of the ideas of Ruffini. He calls it Germanification. I call it German-French primacy, because Germany brings in the Northern Europe, France the Southern Europe, but you really need both. And then the Eastern Europe, which usually comes through Poland as a key pivotal player. And that means that you will have more integration, but not the kind of integration that used to exist before. And you won't have you will have more diversity, but it will come at the expense of the integration as well. And that means that Europe as a sovereign will be less important than the countries that make that sovereign. And that means multi-speed Europe. There will be three layers of Europe. Those that do relatively well, I would say Germans, Nordics, and a few other countries. UK will be a little bit outside, like Norway, will probably make same sort of trade deals that it can function, may lose a significant part of its financial activities to Frankfurt and the rest in Germany, particularly partly to France. And then you will have a second layer of not so fast growing, not so productive European economies like the Southern Europe, particularly France, Spain, Italy, and so on and so forth. Then Eastern Europe, with low GDP per capita, but some actually growing relatively fast, or Slovenia, Czechoslovakia, former Czechoslovakia, which is now at the level of Italy or beyond that in terms of competitiveness. And then there's the case of China, which most likely after this fall will move faster towards reforms, which means it will start tightening pretty fast. And now, for the first time in the post-war history that I know of, most economies are still tightening, very slowly moving towards easing. And that means that there will be less liquidity around. Historically, this has always meant periods of greater geopolitical friction, greater complications within major groupings like G20. So it will get more difficult rather than easier. And finally, here's a McKinsey slides that I use, not because I like them, but because I think that there is a problem with it. They envision four scenarios. One scale has to do with divergence, the other one with the convergence. Will countries go their separate ways? Will they globalize, work together, cooperate? And then what is it? Whether the growth is above 30-year trend or below it. Now, from that scenario, I think that it's fair to say that we were close to the scenario three, even close to the fourth, when the crisis began in 2008. Then there was this move, particularly with the G20, this idea we are all in the same boat, let's work together. And yes, advanced economies still in the emerging economies, we will reform our governance. You will have a greater say, which did not happen ultimately. And so now we're getting the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, and the BRICS Development Bank, and the Oval Plan. But the long and short of it is that there was more effort to cooperation until maybe 2012, 2013. But then with the crisis in spring and some other geopolitical issues, including North Korea, and the economic problems that didn't go away as fast as thought, and now you are here, somewhere here, I believe. In a very difficult transitional situation that can ultimately end up with a great friction on the left-hand side or deceleration. Now, when I said that, I'm using this because it's nice to kind of work your mind on this and use it as a way to think. Would anybody actually come up with the idea why this would be the wrong way to approach this present situation? What's wrong in this way of thinking? To recap, they're using the 30-year trend. Are we going above or below? And then are countries cooperating or not? Those are the major axes. And then we have four boxes. Why would you think that this is wrong? I'll save you from this because I'm not quite sure I'm even right. But the reason I don't like it is that it presumes that what has happened 30 years from 1985 to the present will continue in the future. Growth in the past was based on certain factors that aren't here any longer. Our growth levels are now maybe 50% of what they were 2008 and 9. So what happened 30 years ago is nice and meaningful, historical. But the future may be very, very different. If it's disruptive, then actually thinking this way puts us into the change of the past. Now, this is what I meant in the beginning when I said that it's very important to look past, but sometimes when you stand on the chair, you have to throw the chair away and look what you actually see. And I think this is one of those moments because the future may not be the replica of the past. Okay, thank you.
for the patients. I've talked far too long, but these were some of the aspects that I wanted to present, and the long and short of it that I simply don't see any way that the G20 cooperation would be similar in the future. But let's say that the stakes are becoming far more important, possibly more fatal, and far more problematic. So the only thing that this will do is create a sense of crisis, and if that motivates people to work together, so be it. But in terms of the number of converging negative perfect storms, you have them now.